What's that?
That's the nanny.
Hi.
Shh, don't say anything, but I just upgraded myself from coach.
The nanny began on a plane ride, and on this flight was Jeff Sagansky, who was then the president of CBS.
I'm Fran Fine. What's your name?
Jeff Sagansky, and this is my daughter, Gillian.
And so I started talking to him, and he was essentially a captive audience, because where was he going to go, coach? I was telling him that we really have to come up with a show that fits me hand in glove because I'm too unique.
She said, you know, let me come in with some ideas of my own for a show. Me and my husband have these ideas, and he created some other shows and stuff.
By the end of this 9.5-hour flight, he said, when we both get back to Los Angeles, you call me and we'll set up a meeting for you to pitch your ideas. And I went to visit my girlfriend in London. And her and her husband were busy, so I ended up dragging their little 12-year-old daughter with me all over London. She says to me, Fran, my shoes are hurting me, they're new.
She said, well, just step on the back of them and push the ends down. And she said, well, that'll break them. And she said, no, that'll break them in.
Something seems funny in this. So I called my husband and I said, you know, what do you think about a spin on The Sound of Music? Only instead of Julie Andrews, I'll come to the door.
Hello, I'm Fran Fine.
Yes, come in. We've been expecting you.
Oh, you have?
You are here for the nanny position?
I could be.
Said, that's it. That is the perfect idea for you.
All right, you're hired, but on a trial basis.
Oh, thank you, Mr. Schofield. Thank you so much. You won't regret it.
Somehow, I'm rather sure I will.
And really, the rest is history. Rather than try and water down the things about me that make me unique so that I can fit into some kind of a mold, we decided to bring it right out in the open, make fun of it, and talk about it.
You want to hear a good one? Miss Babcock was saying, I'm going to stick out like a sore thumb at tomorrow's tea party.
It became part of the series that I had a funny voice.
Do I sound like I'm coming down with a cold?
Constantly.
That I had a laugh that, you know, was subhuman.
She just has a funny voice. It's, and she laughs that way.
Maxwell, you described her laugh all wrong in your letters. It's nothing like the QE2 adrift in a fog.
Peter and I always, felt like it's best for us to write about what we know.
You like my party dress? Loan me 70% off.
She'll never shop retail again.
The two of us grew up in such a kind of normal way. I think just putting all these experiences together is what sort of made people relate to it.
The whole show had a very upstairs, downstairs feeling to it. The network didn't want originally the nanny to come down for breakfast in her bathrobe. They thought that it was inappropriate, and it was like, yeah, that's the point. She is inappropriate.
Oh, Miss Fine, another stunning yet inappropriate breakfast ensemble.
You like? They were having a big sale at Victoria's Secrets. I bought some other stuff too, but that's my secret.
Sort of seeing Fran kind of take everything on was, I guess, just sort of how I thought it was done, because I had never done television before. So I think I just sort of assumed that every time, you know, there's a star of a show, she's also writing it and creating it.
If you don't stay tried and true to your vision, you're going to end up compromising.
I beg your pardon?
You know, seize the day, carpe diem.
You speak Latin?
Well, pig.
We figured it was our one chance to do what we really thought was going to work. And if it didn't, it didn't. And if it did, great.
I hate her.
Now, Brighton, let's not be hasty.
Yeah, I haven't even sung Climb Every Mountain yet.
In following the archetypes of The Sound of Music, we needed to have the man that she works for that has a chemistry with her.
Huh, right, let me just get out of this uniform.
No rush.
Oh, Mrs. Sheffield.
I loved working with Charlie Shaughnessy. You know, it's funny because when he auditioned for The Nanny, it was, I guess, a rainy day.
And he came in wearing his little yellow boots.
What happened? You're normally so GQ. Now suddenly you're the Gordon's fisherman.
The first thing, we lose the boots, you know.
He wanted to be this kind of ruffled guy.
You know, this grungy look is very cute on you.
But Fran is the blue-collar character. Fran is the schlub. You have to be the uptight aristocrat. Somehow, he found his father in his performance. Once he did that, it was all good.
I am opening a musical in 8 weeks.
So?
I have no music.
Oh.
Otherwise, I'd love to go. Brighton, don't be so smart. Gracie, dear, take smaller bites. And Maggie, do try to be a bit more outgoing. Well, carry on.
He's got my vote for Father of the Year.
Originally, we just had the two youngest kids, the boy and the girl.
When we were trying to come up with names for the children, we decided if we ever had children of our own, we wanted to name one Brighton and one Grace.
After Gracie Allen. And Brighton, we had heard in a movie, and I just kind of liked that name.
Madeline Zima, who played the little girl, you know, she was like 5 years old when she walked in, and one of the jokes was about the little kid just saying, I don't feel comfortable doing this material.
My mother told me to play Tallulah Bankhead and like Betty Davis, and I was, you know, using some of their influences when I was really, really young and just sort of deepening my voice.
Oh, you have no idea how complicated I am.
We couldn't find a Brighton. We looked all over, and we couldn't find one. And finally, this little kid, Benjamin Salisbury, walked in, and he was great. He was perfect, reading the trades outside, and he was like 12 years old.
So pathetic, Brighton. We both hate you.
Good, then my work here is done.
It was the network that said, we need an older daughter, kind of like a Grace Kelly type, that Fran can teach to become a woman.
A few drops strategically placed on the pulse points. Here, here, and one right between the eyes.
I was very much like my character. Very shy when it having to do with, you know, boys or, you know, I was still climbing trees.
We've got half the money people in New York coming to our backers party, and I will not have those children running loose. Not that I don't love them as if they were my very own.
We interviewed a lot of women for the Cece Babcock role, but when Lauren walked in, she owned it. I mean, in our opinion, we thought that she captured that kind of cool, blonde, wealthy, privileged, upper-class type woman. But she was really, really funny.
People misunderstand me. They think I'm a self-centered, cold-hearted witch.
Lauren, to me, is hilarious. She once told me that her comedic idol was Don Knotts. Now that I know that piece of information, when I go back and look at it, I really see, like, what a gifted physical comedian she really is.
Oh, it doesn't matter why. All that matters is she's okay.
Hey, Sissy, you're smothering the child.
When we were casting for the butler, we loved Daniel Davis, but we thought maybe he was too young. And yet, he was so good. Every movement that he made was so specific, and he was so funny that we thought, you know what, we have to go with him.
Well, you're taking this a lot better than I am. How do you do it?
Oh, please, Miss Fine. I'm a trained professional. I have 30 years' experience.
We knew that I needed to have somebody that I could talk to that was outside of the family, somebody that would make Fran look smart.
May I take your coat?
Do I get a stub?
No, and you don't have to tip him either. Oh, she's got no class. Come on, Val, move your ass.
I wanted my girlfriend in real life, Rachel Chagall, to play that role. I thought that she was absolutely wonderful. Physically, she was a contrast to me. And we had a closeness that I think translated on the screen.
the whole cast got along great.
It was really a match made in heaven.
Oh, my goodness, Miss Fine, what are you wearing?
Well, as far as I'm concerned, our vacation is starting right now.
Fran's wardrobe was my ideal wardrobe.
She always looked great in clothing. And the network said, just dress her in jeans and t-shirts and stuff like that. We said, no, we knew that we wanted her to have a specific look. And I said, this is going to be a major part of the show.
You think this look happens by accident?
I saw this red, shiny dress in the corner, and I said, that would be great if we have everybody else in, like, gray, and you come walking down in this red dress.
What's that?
That's the nanny.
We built the set in a certain tone of color so that she'd be able to wear anything without the set contrasting what she wore. So the whole set was designed around her wardrobe.
I didn't know anything about fashion. All I knew was Fran looked hot and I wanted to be like her.
I just thought she was the coolest thing in the world.
Who wouldn't want a closet like that?
Oh, gee, if I would have known, I would have dressed.
I love doing the pilot.
Do you have any experience with children?
Are you kidding? I practically raised my sister's two kids when she was suing Hesharopodis.
I remember being on the back stairs with Fran and taking all of our hands and being like, okay, we're going to go out there and everything's going to be great.
It was so unreal because I'd never worked in front of a studio audience before, and that is one of those things that almost can be likened to theater in a way. You just feed off the audience's energy, and it just improves your performance.
I thought it was a lot of fun. It quickly became sort of like my joy of the week were these Friday night tapings.
Oh, thank you so much!
The audience was very with us, and there weren't any big stars in the show. They'd never seen the concept before, and yet something about the way it went that night, we knew we had caught lightning in a bottle.
It seems you pulled it off.
What could possibly go wrong when you put a father together with his children?
I think I'm going to be ill.
The first time the show aired, we were having wildfires here in Los Angeles, and it was literally just wall-to-wall news coverage, and I just remember thinking, I hope the show airs. Like, I've put the fires out so the show airs. Like, I had no concept of the overall horribleness that was going on.
When we did the pilot, we got Renee Taylor to play my mother.
Passion goes, sex goes, communication we never had. But food is forever.
It's hard to imagine, but Renee is almost more of a character off screen than she played on screen.
We're very similar in the way we act.
What's with you? Me? What's with you?
When the pilot episode premiered, I was watching it with my real parents, and Peter and I were very nervous about how my mom was going to react. We were worried because we made Renee have big hair, and she was wearing like a muumuu, and it was actually very similar to my mom.
So we watched the whole thing, and Fran's mother was watching it very intensely, and, you know, we're thinking, uh-oh.
And all of a sudden, my mother says, you know, I'm so glad that you didn't exaggerate the hair.
We looked at each other and went, okay.
One time my mom said, you're making our family have no class.
It's 6 o'clock. Comb your father's hair.
As she's telling me this, she's holding a pastrami sandwich with all of the Russian dressing going down the side of her hand like this. And I'm thinking to myself, you know, you don't even know. We're actually being kind to our family.
Grandma Yetta!
Yeah.
Anne came in, who did the Dick Van Dyke Show many years ago as Millie Helper. And she started smoking and coughing like the real Yetta.
Hi, Yetta, you sound like you're making espresso over there.
There was this character that I'd always wanted to do, was noodling around in my head. So I got to use her as Yetta.
She created this whole character by wearing these glasses that she actually couldn't see in.
I haven't seen you since you were this big.
No, Yetta, you've never met him before.
Oh.
My grandmother, the real Yetta, watched the show the first time the character Yetta appeared on the show. And she said, why do you have to put Yetta in a home? I don't live in a home. I have my own apartment. And she sort of was put off by it until she went to the beauty parlor and everybody treated her like she was such a celebrity.
Oh, is my face red?
Well, now it matches the rest of you.
Oh, there's that rapier wit we've come to count on.
After we did the pilot, the studio said, you know, we don't know, we like the dynamic with you and the kids and the father and the butler, and we think we want to reduce the CeCe Babcock role.
I think it was because we had not quite found CeCe, the character of CeCe. We weren't quite sure what to do with her.
We wanted to figure out a way to make her a very important ingredient to the show.
In the pilot, the butler started to insult CeCe.
Theater has always been a passion of mine.
I can't wait to see what you'll be mounting next.
And we got a big laugh, so we said, why don't we try a little more of that? So we had that go back and forth and back and forth, and the network liked that.
I can't show up without an escort.
Why don't you just inflate one like you usually do?
They were such a brilliant couple, those two. It was incredible, and it was just so important to the ongoing success of the series and gave us so much opportunity for laughs.
What is it?
What's the matter?
You killed Imogene!
How? What'd I do?
You ate her!
You ate her?
I did not eat her!
She was sitting on the cookie and you ate her!
Oh, come on. Play!
One of the funniest moments that I remember was that imaginary friend.
That episode became a turning point on The Nanny because that was where the physical comedy began.
We pulled through!
We've done it!
Yeah!
She was so good at it, Fran, that became one of the things that we tried to put in every show.
I enjoy doing it. So, I mean, I grew up and I used to watch Lucy all the time. She did a lot of physical comedy, and it's just, you know, plain old funny.
There was one show we did that was kind of scary where she flew in the rehearsal and the run through, her cable broke and she fell out of the harness and she was up in the air and literally someone caught her from hitting the floor.
Don't worry, I'm okay.
Come here, I want you to meet Tiffany.
Hi.
Hi.
Magic.
I got the script and Brighton and a girl kiss. And I was instantly both, like, ecstatically thrilled and just scared blankless because I had never kissed anybody before. So I was like, this is just going to be a disaster. Because I didn't know how it worked. I didn't know what went where, how all that shook down. I was really scared. And, of course, I had to pretend. You know, I was like, oh, I've kissed plenty of women. This is nothing.
One thing led to another. You know how it is.
And I'm, like, shaking inside. I'm just like, oh, my God, I'm going to be so, like, just completely shown as the fraud that I am right now. So we go to do the scene, and I'm just like, I can't. And the whole crew is there, and I must have been 80 shades of red.
How about a little privacy here?
It was awful, but I'd like to say it worked out quite well. And now I'm just waiting for my second kiss.
The way everything came together, it was almost like it was a, you know, blessed.
Well, it looks like a hit to us.
Oh, thank you, Miss Fine.
I think I was aware of the show being a pretty successful hit when we started beating Fresh Prince of Bel-Air out of the time slot.
After the first season of The Nanny, I decided that I was going to host a dinner party in my backyard just to help ingratiate us with the network right around the time when they were going to be deciding what shows got picked up.
And Fran was wearing this outfit, and we had all these little candles lit all over the place. And
she reached over, and there was a candle on the table, and her shirt, like, caught on fire.
My manager, Elaine, said, "Fran, you're on fire." And she starts, like, swatting me with her napkin.
And she had to take off her shirt. And then there she was, naked with all the suits.
And, of course, we got picked up for the second season.
Ma, pack my things. He wants me back. I'm the nanny.
You are the nanny.
I'm the nanny.